I want to thank, of course, the organizers of the conference and the National Bank, and I have also to thank somebody else, because this project is possible because of an initiative of the bank, which is the Microdata Research Data Hub. And it's a great initiative that will allow researchers from Belgium, but also from abroad, to access the microdata available at the bank. I think it's a great initiative. It's still at the pilot phase, with some issues on data availability, unfortunately, which is why today you'll see the presentation is a bit limited. We got the data last minute. But it's a great initiative, and it will bring the MBB on the spotlight of the international community of researchers. So my thanks to Katrine, who's in the audience, and to everybody behind the project. Keep pushing despite the problems. Okay, having said this, our project is about the Belgian green transition and how it went so far and how to think about the future. Okay, and it's together with Estelle Cantillon, also from ULB. So the motivation is something that we have already seen in other presentations. The green transition will change the economic landscape of the economy. And as we expect, it will be a supply side shock, which will impact the way we produce products, through changes in the cost of inputs and through changes in the technology, so the way we produce these inputs, the products. Now, as obvious, this will create winners and losers. Some firms will thrive and rise, other firms will fail, and the same will potentially happen for entire industries, okay? So in a transition like this, a country, whether it's Belgium, or if you think more at large, the EU, a confederation of countries, has to think, okay, what are the opportunities that we're gonna exploit if we don't want to miss them, okay? Of course, the ability to exploit the opportunities that will take place will depend on the capabilities of, in our case, the Belgian economy. Now, our starting point is the graph that you see here, and it's taken from the Green Transition Navigator, which is a project of the London School of Economics. And what I'm plotting here is the Green Complexity Index for Belgium and neighboring countries in the last 20 years. So I selected Germany, France, and the Netherlands. I will say more about the Green Complexity Index just in the next slide, but for you to know, for those who don't know it, it's a measure of the complexity of an economy, okay, vis-a-vis the rest of the world, okay? And what you see in this graph, if you look at the green line, is that Belgium started the new millennium in a relatively good position, being in the top 20, but then it's steadily lost ground, not only to big rising economies like China, which is something that you can expect, but also to some of the peers, also in the EU, okay? So then the question is why, okay? And first of all, one wants to think, okay, what are we capturing with this index? What you see here is one of the only two formulas that I'm going to show you, and I'm going to explain just now. So the Green Complexity Index is the sum over a list of products. It's constructed in this way. Summing over a list of products can be all the products produced in an economy or a subset. In our case, it's a subset of green products. And then it's the product of two elements. One is the relative comparative advantage, which is basically the number of products in which you have a comparative advantage vis-a-vis the other countries. And how do we measure this? Looking at trade flows. Having the idea that if I trade more of a certain product, it's because my product is relatively better than the competition, okay? So the first element is how large is the portfolio of product in which you have a comparative advantage vis-a-vis the rest of the world. The second element, so the, sorry, I could have used this, the PCI, is how complex these products are. So just to make an example, thinking about opposite cases, if you are a country without an industrial base that is mainly exporting raw materials, oil, minerals, you're gonna have a small number of products in which you have a comparative advantage, few, and they are not complex. So you're gonna have a low index of complexity, okay? On the opposite, and here maybe I can make an example, if you are Japan or Germany or the US, you have a complex economy, you have a strong manufacturing sector, then you can have potentially a large number of products in which you have a comparative advantage, and these products are complex, okay? And then you're gonna have a high index. What I showed you was the green complexity index, so it's this index, but based on the list of green products, okay? So restricting the analysis to that. Okay, so we are talking about green economy. There are different approaches around to capture different dimensions of what is green. For example, some institutions have developed a list, a criteria, and so a list of green products. Then you have definitions and of what is a green firm and what is a green innovation. For our meta, what is important is the list of green products, and on that we follow the work of Mealy and Teylenbaum, who compile the list of products based on various sources. Okay? This can be readily applied to trade data because they are at the HS6 level, which is a classic taxonomy for trade data. Now, as I said, unfortunately, we were about to cancel the presentation because we really got the data late, but we wanted to also use it as a commitment. For this for today, I'm really restricting myself to very simple descriptive analysis along the lines of a main research question, which is what explains the relative decline in Belgium competitiveness in green economy. I will show some stylized facts on the underlying industry dynamics, and I don't want to tell you too much now and what I'm going to show you, but I will mainly talk about the reduction in the relative competitive advantage of Belgian manufacturing, what's going on with investments, and the fact that based on our stylized facts, we can already rule out some alternative explanations, like that instead of trading, we are using this product domestically, which is not the case, or at least we don't have evidence that this is the case. Now, we are talking to different strands of literature. So first of all, the literature on economic linkages and supply chains, capabilities, and so on. We are talking to the literature on industry transformation, and so the papers on path dependence, the papers on the role of innovation in a transition, and the transition risk papers. And of course, we are related to the literature on green industrial policy, because it's not today, but for the future steps of the project, we want to study the impact of industrial policy in the years that we cover in the data. What do we know already about what's going on in the green transition, and more specifically in Belgium? So literature has shown that green products tend to be more complex than non-green products. And innovation in green technologies also brings more spillovers, okay? And here I'm referring also to a paper of one of the discussants of today. We also know that investments in green technologies and in green products, they tend to suffer a lot from policy uncertainty and can be hit severely by low energy prices. More specifically about Belgium, we know that, unfortunately, Belgium is kind of declining in the patent activity in climate change and mitigation technology, and there is a nice work by Karin Swartenbroeks, if I pronounce it correctly, who works at the MBB. We also know that, thanks to a paper by Hans de Greze and co-authors, we know that Belgian banks tend to be reluctant to lend to innovators in these industries. But there are some good news from work of the Belgian Federal Planning Bureau on the growth of environmental goods and services vis-a-vis the rest of the economy. Okay, so there is a mixed picture with some element of pessimism, but yeah, that's how it looks like. So, as I said, thanks to the initiative of the MBB, we will leverage access to some micro data from the MBB, but there is already something we can learn from more aggregated trade data that is publicly available. And so here I'm proposing just a simple decomposition of the Green Complexity Index, because as I showed you, it's gonna be a function of how large your portfolio of products over which you have a competitive advantage is and how complex they are. So if this index is changing, it's either because your portfolio is changing, reducing or increasing, or because the products that you produce are changing in their complexity. So you are moving up in the complexity or down, okay? And it's the simple decomposition I'm showing. So if you look at trade data, it seems that the first element is active. So there is a reduction in the number of products in which the Belgian manufacturing has a competitive advantage vis-a-vis the international competition, okay? Regarding the second, let's hold on. I will show you the evidence when I will move to the micro data, okay? The second thing that you can learn from trade data, and something that we could see even before access to the MBB data, is that there is some heterogeneity between product categories. And I hope you can see well, but Belgium is this red line here. So the performance of the country when you look at energy efficiency products is more or less stable throughout the first two decades of the 2000s. Waste management is actually improving. So the blue line is Germany and the green line are the Dutch. But there is one category in particular, the remaining category is gonna be a miscellanea of products, but there is one category in particular that is declining, as is the pollution monitoring. So firms in this product category are facing tougher and tougher competition and they are losing ground, okay? Okay, I talked about having access to this great data, and let me show you what the MBB is giving us. The data set is a combination of different data sets that have been put together by the team, and they include balance sheet data, so we can observe balance sheet information, turnover, investments, whatever you can think. Then we have access to PRODCOM data, which is production data, and it's at the firm year product category. I mean, nice granularity, so at CN8 level, so pretty granular. And then it's also linked to trade of firms. So for every single firm, we observe balance sheet, production, and trade, okay? We integrate the data with information on green products, which again, we obtain from this project from the London School of Economics. And we will also leverage other data sets that are available at the bank, like employment survey and so on. The data spans the first two decades of the 2000s, but we are still in the process of actually cleaning and exploring the data, and for today it's only 2000 to 2017. So for this presentation, I will mainly show you stylized facts on series of variables. So the number of firms and their size, the volume of production and the volume of trade, both volumes and values, the investments, the employment, and the value added. Okay, and how it's evolving over time. Now, it's important to notice that I'm not talking about services, which are very important. I'm only talking about manufacturing because we have access to PRODCOM and everything is made consistent and harmonized with PRODCOM, okay? So it's only about manufacturing. So this is the first graph I can show you. First dive into the data. The solid line is the number of firms, manufacturing firms in Belgium over time. The threshold to be included in Prodcom is more than 20 employees. And you see, it's declining. At the beginning of 2000s, the number of surveyed firms was 5,500, and at the end of the sample is less than 3,000, it's 2,695. There is a process of consolidation, so some of them are not really disappearing, they're just merging, but there is an important exit also going on. The China shock, and so on. Together with this process of exit, which also impacted green firms seem to be exit at less rate, and they are actually increasing their share in the Belgian manufacturing, moving from around 20%, around 12.5% to 14.5%, so increasing by approximately 16%. Second graph that I want to show you, it's about how important are green products in the production of firms, and is it going up or down over time? So here you see you have the answer. So with what I call here green ratio is just the ratio between the volume of green products in the production of firm over the total, or the value of the green production over the total. The dashed line is in volume, and the solid line is in value. And here we see that we still, or at least in 2017, we still we are still below the values of the beginning of the 2000s, and they account for around between 6 and 7%. Okay, so not large and also not growing, or maybe it's growing in the last 5 years. We will know soon. There is an important, or there is a non-negligible decline in volume, so it's minus 8%. But in terms of value, it's not a large drop. It's only 0.3%. This is the growth rate over time of production value. And here I'm showing you in green, green production, and in black, non-green production. Growth rates are similar. I mean, it's consistent with the previous graph that showed you that more or less the importance of green production is stable, at least in the last 10 years. So it's not really growing more. So the green economy is not really growing more than the non-green economy in Belgian manufacturing. This is trade. Okay, so this is how important is green trade for the trade of Belgian manufacturing firms. Again, the picture is, we are talking about 5%, both in volume and in values. There was a drop around the financial crisis of green products, which then recovered. Now they are on an increasing path, but we are still, or at least in 2017, they were still just at the level of the beginning of the decade. Finally, I can show you something on the product complexity. So before I said it's a story, for sure it's a story about losing ground in terms of the breadth of the portfolio of green products over which we have a competitive advantage. What about their complexity? Complexity is pretty stable. So manufacturing is not moving up in the complexity scale, and it's rather stable both if you look at production and if you look at trade. It's not that maybe production is doing better, but we still don't trade it, or vice versa. Okay. Here I'm showing you how important is the green trade for the firms that we label as green, and to be labeled green, it's enough that you produce at least one product category that is labeled green, according to paper that I cited before. And of course, I mean, this is what you expect. So for green firms, green products are more important, not 5%, but around 15%. But the pattern is similar. So there was an initial drop in the first decade of the 2000s, and then a recovery. Okay. The recovery just brought them back to the pre-financial crisis levels. So this is the full-time equivalent. So here I'm talking about employment. I mean, as I showed you, there is a large exit in the market, manufacturing firm shutting down and exiting. So it's not surprising that the overall full-time equivalents of Belgian manufacturing sector is declining. It's maybe more interesting to look at firm average. So you see there is a big jump when the bulk of exit took place, which is the financial crisis. After that, it's pretty stable. Okay, so the average Belgian firm then maintain a stable number of full-time equivalents. And it's a similar pattern if we do not restrict to green firms. Here I just wanted to show you what's going on with the green firms. What about the total investments? You know, it's interesting to look at the aggregate as well and not just at the firm average. So overall investments due to the exit of manufacturing are in aggregate declining. Although assets are going up. And if you look at firm averages, everything I'm showing you is in 2,000 euros, so I'm deflating everything to the base year. If you look at investments, on average, per firm, we are talking about 1.2 million. That's the average investment of a Belgian manufacturing firm with more than 20 employees. There is some variability at the beginning of the decade. Then it gets less volatile, and there is a bit of going up towards 2017. But it's rather stable throughout, the, on average, the first two decades of the 2000s. This is value added, again, total value added for the manufacturing sector going down because of the exit, not surprising. But if you look at firm average, the survival of the exit process, they are firms with higher value added, okay? I mean, it's obvious to think that the firms that exit are weaker firms, they are less capitalized, they are less productive, and so they have lower value added. And once you get, once these firms get out, the those who remain, they're stronger firms that generate more value added. One thing that we could, that we wanted to see is whether they also pay better for the employees, and seems so. So they give better compensations to their workers. Probably they would, I mean, they are already doing since the beginning, and then those who survive, again, they are the firms that produce more value added and pay better their employees because probably they have better employees on average than those who exit. Finally, let me just show you what I showed you so far, but checking what the difference between green and non-green firms. So this is average investments, and the dashed line is green firms. The solid line is non-green. And this is a bit, maybe one of the driving factors for the loss of competitiveness of the green firms in Belgium. They were comparable in terms of investments in the first part of the 2000s. Actually, green firms were leading. They were investing more on average, but then in the second decade, they lagged behind in terms of investments. This is just an interpolation of the data with the local polynomial, but the trend is kind of there. Here I'm, you remember the four categories, the categories that I showed you using the trade data. So I'm looking at investments by, so separate, dividing the firms based on these categories. If you remember, energy efficiency firms, they were doing relatively stable, so they were in a, they had a good ranking and they were kind of stable in this ranking, and their investments, they tend to be stable. Pollution monitoring were those that were really losing ground, and we see a strong decline in their investments. We want to dig into this. Maybe they realized the competition from Asia was possible to beat. They started to exit, they started to divest, And then, the result is what we saw in the ranking. For the other categories, the waste management and the miscellanea, so the miscellanea of remaining categories, there was an initial decline, but then they went up again. About value added and compensation and workers' compensation, maybe something positive about the green sector in Belgium. They tend to be firms with higher value added, and they tend to pay better their employees. Okay, so the dashed green line is the green sector, and the solid black is the non-green. So to wrap up in my last minute, as I said, we observed a decline in the green complexity index, and I try to emphasize the fact that this is coming from a reduced competitive advantage in the portfolio of green products, not by a decline in their complexity. And in this process, we observe some heterogeneity. We think there is an important role of industry dynamics beyond the contraction of the manufacturing sector, which took place in every country in Europe. We see that something is going on, especially on investments, okay? And they seem to play a role. But still, there are some positive signs, if you want, from this sector. On average, they have higher value added and higher salaries. Now, what do we plan to do next? And here, your input, I guess, will be extremely important if you want to approach us after the seminar, after this talk, or during the questions. We want to now move on and really study what's driving investments, what's driving patenting activities of this firm. We are going to leverage the possibility to merge the data with PathStat. We have a lot of things in mind. We want to check whether firms that are doing better are also those that have more international linkages, and so maybe they are part of multinational groups. We also want to, as I said, to study the role of industrial policy. For example, initiatives like the regional competitive clusters. Okay, so I studied their impact so far. As I said, there is an important caveat to what I showed you. This is based on manufacturing, but it's only part of the story. That's why we are also thinking about extending the analysis to services, and we have an idea on how to do it, given the importance of services for modern economies, of course. Thanks.
Thank you.